Hi everyone, it's Jai452 here, back inside this closet of cosplay. Will we ever get out of here? Who knows? But today I think we've got a very good helping hand in.
ShiroiOji Cosplay.
Hello, Shirai. How are you today?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. It's a beautiful day here in sunny Scotland. So I just want to jump right into this interview and ask you, when did you first start cosplaying?
casually, I really started back in about 2011, but it wasn't until like the past year or so. I would say this past Halloween is when I really got into it severely. That's a lie. 2014, going to Kineticon got me pretty much hooked, and I had to keep upping my game. So, yeah, officially I'd say 2014, June or July.
Do you remember what your first cosplay was?
Well, my first unofficial cosplay was a completely inappropriate sexy Captain America. But my first actual cosplay was Kai Kisuke from the fighting game Guilty Gear. I just really liked that guy.
Awesome. Who or what inspires you to cosplay?
Well, I've always loved costumes. I've always loved superheroes. I've always loved dressing up. Growing up, for me, I mean, I'm old enough that if you bought a superhero costume, what it was a plastic mask with a plastic smock that basically had the superhero's name across it. So growing up, the costumes did not look like superheroes, which was really, really disappointing for me. And I always wanted to push it further. I mean, some of my big inspirations, when it comes to cosplay are people like Kelton Ching, who does the absolute most amazing makeups, Jimmy Sherfy, who, I mean, not only is he really nice, but he's just got such great, great cosplay. He brings anime right to life. And then, you know, honestly, like every single person that I cosplayed with at FlameCon this year was such an inspiration. And I mean, I really got to up my game again.
You mentioned a good few people there. Are all of those people's, well, the ones that you mentioned by name, do they still cosplay or have they kind of started to wind it down a bit?
Oh, no, they're people who are very active. I mean, Jimmy Sherfy actually works in a for a princess party company. Mm-hmm. You know, Kelton Ching is actually working in special effects makeup, and he has done just some absolutely amazing things. I mean, his Poison Ivy is head and shoulders above mine, honestly. It's fantastic. Every thing he puts out is fantastic, and it really pushes me to do better with my work. So I appreciate everything he does.
Now the next question I have for you, now it's going to be a bit of a two-parter. And when I say two-parter, because when it comes to cosplay, we don't just wear costumes and wander around and be like, "Hi, I'm that character you know from whatever."
Right.
There is a little bit of acting involved in cosplay, whether it just be mimicking the character's voice or how they would stand or even just how they interact with the general or would interact with the general public. So my question for you is, what has been the most challenging cosplay that you've ever done, both from an acting point of view and the making of a costume? So let's start with the acting side. Which one have you done to date has been the most challenging for you?
Spider-Man is the one that pushed me the hardest physically. I actually have a friend who is a fifth degree black belt and runs his own dojo. So, he also, auditioned for a lot of the Marvel, movies and live shows and stuff. So I actually trained with him for several weeks to, really make sure that my poses were on point. I spent a lot of time looking at pictures of other cosplayers, and I could figure out that something was wrong, and I needed some help pushing myself to figure out what was not wrong, not satisfying to me, something that I wanted to push myself further. And he really helped me, but he really pushed me physically. And there were quite a few days where stairs were not my friend after working with him. And quite honestly, anytime I do Spider-Man for any extended amount of time, the next 2 days are not ones where my legs enjoy being attached to me.
Understandably. I have a friend who also does Spider-Man quite commonly, and I think he's from, I want to say, Russia.
Okay.
And I could be wrong, just putting that out there. Just seeing all the different things that he does in terms of Spider-Man, he really does have the posing down, the physique down, and the costume on top of that as well. It's like, wow. You
know, yeah.
Just how much you go through to be in a position to even do that kind of thing. I think there's a video on Facebook somewhere of him with a few friends, and they're kind of like at a con, and they're like play fighting for a scenario. And you see him doing all these kind of like capoeira moves.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, oh my god, you know, because, wow. Because capoeira is not easy. It's like, if you ask me, it's probably one of the more complex martial arts that you could probably learn.
Definitely.
But, wow. So, you said that Spider-Man was the most demanding physically. What has been the most demanding in terms of the costume? Like, what one has really made you want to scream, basically?
Poison Ivy. Despite the fact that there's very little clothing, because I mean, gender bending Poison Ivy, I basically spent several weeks sewing leaf by leaf by leaf onto a pair of underwear and a shrug. And it was such tedious, frustrating, slow going work. I wanted to shoot myself or somebody else in the face 90% of the time.
Okay. Now, you and me have both done Poison Ivy.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember contacting you specifically after I had done Poison Ivy and asking, how the hell did you do that? You know, just how the hell? And you'd said to me, oh, I just stitched them in. And I was like, I really wish I'd have thought of that. Because the costume that I was wearing, it was just like, it was based on the Uma Thurman when she first like shoots out the ground in that god awful Batman and Robin movie.
I don't, that movie never happened, so I don't know what you're talking about.
But I was telling people that's what my costume is based off of. It's based off that first time when we see Uma Thurman. But it was so, so annoying to move in that costume. Because the vines that we had wrapped around my arms just kept slipping, so I'd have to stop and adjust them.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that the leaves were getting, the leaves / vines were getting tangled up in each other, and I had to spend like maybe 5, 10, 20 minutes untangling them before I moved again. So when I seen your one, I was like, oh my god, I wished I had the foresight to think of something like that.
Well, and I mean, that's one of the frustrating things about cosplay is you think, okay, well, I've got this all set. This is what I'm going to do. And then you can think of a much easier way to do something or a much less complicated way. And you're just like, why didn't I do it this way the whole time? It would have been so much faster or easier.
I got to ask, was it, like, I mentioned to you how difficult it was for me to get around in that particular costume. How difficult was it for you when you did Poison Ivy? Were you able to move quite easily?
If I didn't have my carnivorous plant on, it was a lot easier to walk around. But because there's the two pieces that stick out from my waist. Now, I'm generally a pretty tiny guy. I'm all of 5'5". You know, so that's I honestly, I can't even tell you how many centimeters it is. I'll tell you that it's 65 inches.
5.5 is actually a good thing because that's the metric system we use over here.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, so I'm rather small. And but then like to suddenly have I'm kind of doubled in width because of those plant heads, and those are actually a lot more tough than they look. They can take a lot more punishment than you would think because there's barely any damage from getting all the way from Connecticut to New York, taking the, I'm sorry, Connecticut to New Jersey, then taking the subway to New York, and walking around a convention all day long, and then the reverse. There was no real damage to any of them. But it was a pain getting past people, having people walk backwards and not pay attention to where they're going because it's a convention and that's what happens. I mean, already I want to remake it because I've thought of some other cool things that I could do on it to really make it more epic.
I know for a fact, that I'll be going away again in November to another Comic Con, in the United Kingdom. And somebody asked me when I told them I was going, they're like, "Oh, are you bringing your poison ivy?" And I'm like, "No, no." And they're like, "What? Oh, why not?" And I said, "Because not only was my poison ivy difficult to move around the con in, I had to do two full circuits of the con before I even got changed, and then another two after I got changed. I was just there was stuff about it that I liked and stuff that I didn't like after I seen the pictures, because I got a lot of the pictures that first day, and I was like, I don't like that. But it wasn't just that. It's just over in the United Kingdom, I feel poison ivy is a very set time of year. You could only really get away with wearing that costume at certain times of the year, and that's mostly the summer and the spring. Because when it gets to the winter over here, it's very, very, very cold. So I was like, there is no way that I'm walking around a con half dressed and probably pick up the cold. I was lucky that I didn't get it from that one.
Or pneumonia.
I was lucky that I didn't get it from just going to that con. I was actually. I just had the cold before going to the con, so I was so, please, I don't want to get the cold again. But I know a lot of people at the con that I'll be going to will want to come up and be like, "Hi, how are you?" and hug me and all the rest. So I feel better doing Harley in that respect because then people can actually come up to me. Now, I do know for a fact that you were using body paint when you did your male ivy.
A lot of it.
I didn't choose to do that. I was like, nah, I don't have the time for body paint. How was that? Take me through that kind of process.
It was a lot easier than you would think. I bought an airbrush, and it actually came with a specific type of body paint. And then, because I'm neurotic about my cosplay, because come on, every good cosplayer is neurotic.
Oh, yeah.
I bought two more bottles of the same type because I just had nightmares about running out and needing a lot more. Now my what was frustrating is that the airbrush that it showed in the ad was not the same as the one I got. So the airbrush is about this long, but there was a teeny tiny cup on top where the makeup would go. So we would get like a very small piece of me done, and we would have to put more paint in it. Since then, I put another airbrush head on my list for my birthday, and I did just get it. So yay! It has a bigger jar, so it will suck up the paint, and I can mix my own colors. As much as I do like the way Poison Ivy came out, I would like a much lighter green next time I do him. just because I thought it was really cool, especially when I was taking pictures in the trees and stuff. But I want something that's going to be more bold and comic booky.
I got to see your Poison Ivy pictures practically the same day as I came home from that con, and I was like, oh wow, I'm not the only one who's seeing Poison Ivy today. That was my initial reaction.
Right.
But
did you do yours on the Sunday?
No, I did mine on the Saturday.
Okay, so you did yours the day before I did mine.
Mm-hmm. But I didn't really get the chance when I got home on the Saturday because it was very late when we got home.
Mm-hmm.
Well, late for me, early probably in the afternoon for you.
Yeah.
But I was just like, I'm not even going to look at anything. I'm just going to go to bed and then I'll look at it tomorrow kind of thing. And when I seen yours, I was like, oh, thank God. So my next question for you is, in your opinion, what is the most difficult thing or character to cosplay as? Now, this is just a general opinion of your own kind of thing.
What is the most difficult thing to cosplay as? I honestly don't know how to answer that. I mean, I guess anything that requires heavy restrictive armor is really difficult for me. I have a Phoenix 5 Cyclops that I do. And it cements my shoulders are stuck like this the whole time. And I can't really move, you know, but for like this. So it's kind of like being a Ken doll or something. It's really restrictive. And then on top of it, my head is covered. I've got a very thin piece that I can see through. So I can barely hear. I can barely see. I can barely move. And if I have to pee, I have to take everything off. And, you know, it hurts to take that armor off because, you know, it's stiff foam. And there's two pieces that scrape up the side of my head when I'm taking it off. Otherwise, it would look, you know, the collar would be out to here. So that one's really tough. That's one, you know, once you're in it, you're not drinking all day long. You just, that's against the rules. But it still looks really good, so I like wearing it. Cosplay is not about feeling good. It's about looking good.
I like that one.
You feel good inside, not on the outside.
So, from looking at your pictures of your cosplay, you do a lot of comic book characters and some anime characters. Have you ever done any cosplay that's geared towards a certain age group, or is it just all of what you want to do?
I mean, it depends. A lot of the superheroes that I'm trying to do more superheroes that are well known, because I've started doing a lot of really cool charity events. If you check out my cosplay page on Facebook, there's a few charity events I've done. Like, I did a, you know, Finish at the 50, which was for a cancer fundraiser, and I did the Latino Family Festival up in Boston. And I mean, that's really cool because I get to dress up as superheroes that kids love and hang out with them and take pictures with them all day long. And I mean, I think I know you didn't really ask this, but I'm gonna talk about it anyway. The best thing that's happened to me at one of these is I was dressed as my future foundation Spider-Man, which is the mainly white suit with the black accents.
Yeah.
And this little kid was hiding behind his mother's leg. And so I squatted down, you know, just like Spider-Man, and I didn't say anything. He came running at me, threw his arms around my neck in the biggest hug. And, you know, there's a meme, a Disney princess meme that I really took to heart, where, you know, if a kid hugs you, you don't let go until they let go, because you don't know how long they need it. he hugged me for the longest time, to the point where I was like, okay, this is starting to get weird. I don't know what to do. But then he turned around and, like, we have a picture. If you look in my regular Facebook at my profile pictures, it's like the fourth picture or so. I mean, he's beaming. This beautiful little boy was so happy to meet Spider-Man, and it was really cool. I'm currently waiting for the Insomniac Spider-Man costume, because that's about as mainstream Spidey as I want. Because here's the funny thing, I've never been into Spider-Man as much as I love being him. Like, all his side characters are awesome. Spider-Man, kind of boy, but I like being him. Like, I don't like reading him, but I like being him. And the Insomniac costume is pretty hot, so I had to order that from Zentai Zone, because it's affordable, but I know the quality is good. Because I don't have the chops to make that.
Funny you should mention the interaction with the kid there, because I had a similar experience at my very first Comic-Con. Mm-hmm. I was doing Gender Bent Harley, and I had my hammer, which I made myself, just from cardboard. It's like this really cheap looking hammer. And a jacket that a friend made for me, which was in the style of Harley's old, or her classic outfit. Mm-hmm. There's this little boy walking around the corner with his dad, and he just pointed at me and went, "Dad, look." And I turned, because I heard him, like, saying it, and I was like, hi. And he's like, oh, Dad, Harley spoke to me. And I'm like, oh my god, that's so cute. And then another dad with his son actually ran up to me at one point. And I was like, oh god, oh god. Just, oh god. Because obviously at my first con, I just didn't know what to expect.
Right.
And the dad was like, hey, do you mind if I get a picture with you and my son together? And I was like, oh, that's what you wanted. Yeah, sure, no problem. So we had this kid who was standing there with me, and he was just like so bored. He was like, Dad, can I please just go? And I'm like, oh my god. So I was like, I said to him, do you want to hold my hammer? And he's like, can I? He sparked up then, and I was like, oh, thank God for that. But I thought that was so interesting. First, that young little kid who was just so psyched to see Harley walking around, and the fact that I spoke to him, he was just like,
right.
And then this other kid just been kind of like, Dad, can I go? Can I go? I thought, okay, so who was really wanting the picture there, the kid or the dad?
Right,
the dad. Have you ever had instances like that where parents run up to you and say, can I get a picture of you with my kid? And the kid's just been like, what a go.
You know, not really. I think when I'm at cons, I don't really pay a lot of attention. When people aren't interested, I kind of try to respect their boundaries and whatever. At Kineticon this past year, that's where I did the hooded Spider-Man that I do. Mm-hmm. There was a kid who, like, he looked up at me and my friend, Lady J Cosplay. She was dressed as Black Cat, and he looked so, like, at first he looked so excited, and then he looked so upset. So we kind of walked over to him, because we didn't know what was up, and we're like, hey, are you okay? And he's like, I want a picture with you guys, but my dad's phone is dead. So I'm like, I can take it on my phone and just send it to you. That's fine. And like, suddenly he's beaming again, totally excited. So one of the pictures on my cosplay page has, for some reason, it's funny, because me being as small as I am, not only in, you know, height, but come on, I'm far from the most muscular guy out there. I have a thing. I just love picking people up for pictures. So there's a picture of me scooping him up, and, you know, my friend looking really amused, and, you know, we texted it over to the dad. We never heard back, but that's cool, because, you know, I know the kid's still happy getting the picture, so it's all good.
So let's talk about Comic Cons in general now. There are two types of Comic Cons, in my opinion. There might be more in your opinion, I don't know.
Okay.
But there's your big once a year ones like your Dragon Con, your BlizzCon, your San Diego Comic Con, ones that only really happen once a year. And then there's your small local ones, which will happen every maybe 2 months or every month. Which out of the two do you prefer going to? Do you prefer going to the big ones, the small local ones, or do you like a blend of the two?
I like good cons because I've been to really big cons that suck and really little cons that are amazing and really big cons that are amazing and really little cons that you're like, why did I get out of bed? I mean, there's a con in my town, the town that I just moved into, a year ago, and they're working on building themselves up, and I really want to support them. I want to show up, but it's like after walking around once, you're like, okay, I've really done everything that there is to do here. There's no panels. I don't go to the game room personally. I mean, I'm all about board games and stuff, but I have people over to my house to play board games. I don't want to play with strangers. It's funny because as friendly as I am, I don't really like people.
That's absolutely fine.
I get my ADHD gets me a little bit overwhelmed at some cons. This year is my first time going to a really big con. I will be at New York Comic Con only for Saturday, because 4 days at a con is just too much for me. And I mean, I was supposed to be at Flame Con for 3 days, but only some stuff happened. I had to come home early, and I only got there for 2 days. It was still amazing. I mean, it was a, I would say a small, medium-sized con, if that makes sense. But I mean, it was so well done. It was a blast to be at. Kineticon is until now the biggest con I've been to, and they do an amazing job. I guess that and Anime Next, which is down in New Jersey, which is another, like, they have several hotels, so it's all spread out and it's really cool. There's some other cons I've been to, and I won't be petty and name names, but I went and I was like, I don't like it here. The lighting is bad. The venue does not suit what we're doing here. I went as Alan Walker to one of these cons, and they had oversold the place so much and had the rows so thin that I had to walk like this. And I've got these nails that are like this big on that costume, and so I had to like bring my hand in and basically have my costume pressed up against me just to get through anywhere. And then it was doubly frustrating because then everyone thought I was Edward Scissorhands all day long. And Alan Walker does not look like Edward Scissorhands. Come on now.
Because when I ask that question, a lot of people say that they like a blend of the two cons. They like a bit of the big con that only really happen once a year, and a lot about the smaller one. And when I ask why, they always say the kind of same thing. Like the big con is good to go for the experience, but it's very difficult to socialize with anyone. Very, very difficult. It's like you get 5 minutes to talk to somebody, and then you have to go off and do something else, or they have to go off and do something else. Whereas at a smaller local one, you can sit and talk with someone for a good maybe hour and a half. So I can understand that because I have had the chance to do big cons and small cons as well, and I have to admit I lean towards the smaller cons because I do like to socialize with someone for longer than 5 minutes, and then they have to be taken away, or I have to be taken away. So I get it from that perspective. When you've been going to these Comic Con events, what is the one thing that you're most excited about?
I mean, being in costume with my friends again. I mean, I really enjoy when my friends and I can all go in a theme. I'm really hoping that my best friend's costume goes through. He's working, well, I guess I'm not supposed to say. He's working on an event. I won't say what one. Because he's been posting hints about it on his Instagram rather than just telling people what it is. I'm doing Captain America. Lady J is doing Black Widow, and Jay Jester cosplay is going to be doing Winter Soldier. In addition to that, Essex cosplay is coming up from Atlanta, and he's going to be gender bending the Scarlet Witch. So we have like this crew together, and like there's something just so epic about, walking around with your crew. I mean, I'm not gonna lie, at Anime Boston, we were doing that's where we did a bunch of Spider-Man stuff, and it was funny actually because my best friend wasn't in Spider-Man, he was actually in Nightcrawler. But as we were walking around, I'd be like, hey, how many people do you think are going to take pictures if we just like drop into poses right here? So, like it would be really fun because you just do it and suddenly you're surrounded in photographers. And it was one of the most fun ways to get awesome pictures of our cosplay because people would just like come running to get the pictures.
I haven't had the chance to do that yet because it's a lot of the people that I know that cosplay live a good hour and something away from me, and travel is a
Right.
pain in the ass. But I would love to do something like that. And one of the things I'd love to do at some point, and one of my friends is actually discussing doing this. She's planning to go to America and try and attend some of the Comic Cons, and she's like, it's the next step for her. And I was like, oh, well, I've only recently just started cosplaying last year. Like,
Right.
that's a dream of mine too, to be able to go over to the States, because like, you guys are so lucky because it's such a big thing over there. Over here, it's only just starting to pick up speed with the likes of London Film and Comic Con and various other places. But I would definitely love to just go to America and just go to a Comic Con. Maybe not necessarily cosplay at one, but I'd definitely love to do that. So equally with what you're most excited about when you go to an event, what is the one thing that makes you or used to be most nerve-wracking for you?
Body odor. I mean, like, when you run across con funk, it's like, people, shower. It's not hard. Like, I will buy you soap. Like, I will buy you shampoo. I don't care. Like, there is no excuse when you know you're going to be packed in with 50 billion other people, at least smell good. I mean, there's going to be all sorts of wacky personalities, and people are going to have their neuroses and stuff. 'Cause come on, I mean, we're geeks, and a lot of us haven't been treated really nicely, and so as a result, a lot of us don't have very good people skills. I have no problem with that. Be as freaky, weird, whatever as you want, but at least don't smell bad, like. I am though the guy, if you can't tell, I mean, tact is not my friend. So, I am the guy that if you're skeeving on one of my girlfriends, I will give you like not just a piece of my mind, I will give you a piece of everybody's mind. 'Cause get your hands off my girls.
Okay, so that's good. Now I don't know what they're called over in, or what it's called over in the States, whether it's just the competition or whether it's the same as what we call it. But over here we have a competition called the Cosplay Masquerade.
Oh yeah, same thing here.
Okay. So having entered into a couple of them, this year having done the skit from Poison Ivy, I was like, oh my god. Do you guys do the same thing? Like you go on, you do like maybe a skit if you want to do a skit, or if you don't want to do a skit, you pose for the judges just to like kind of show off the outfit. This year I did the skit and I forgot to pose after it, and I was like, oh my god. And somebody actually posted a video of the skit that I did.
Oh wow.
And I was like, oh right, awesome. And then I just kind of realized I sat the microphone down and walked off stage without posing, and I was like, damn it, you know, just
you're Poison Ivy, you're in character for that.
That never dawned on me.
Poison Ivy doesn't pay attention to rules. You're good.
So when you've entered into these competitions, have you ever won anything? And what was running through your head when you got called up?
Okay, so here's the thing. Despite the fact that I actually judged a masquerade, Kineticon 2015, and that was a lot of fun. I had not entered a masquerade until just FlameCon as Poison Ivy. And it was funny because, I mean, I was having the worst day. Like, I wanted to leave New York at, like, 3 a.m. the night before, just because, you know, like I said, some stuff happened. It was, I didn't sleep. But I was like, I have worked too hard on this Poison Ivy. I am not going home until I've done all day in green body paint. So I did that. I stuck with it. My best friend was dressed as Harley, or he calls him Harvey Quinn. And then our friend Nephilim Rising was doing Robin, which, you know, he was basically wearing underwear and a cape with the things stuck with prosaid to his chest. And, you know, we didn't have a skit. We knew we wanted to do the contest, which we didn't know that there was going to be, you know, a masquerade slash contest. And for the most part, they were just having people walk across the stage, stop, pose, spin around, show the whole costume, and then walk off. But when we went up, I was, you know, it was the three of us. We all showed our costumes. Then I grabbed Michael and I kissed him full on the lips, and he collapsed, you know, cause oh honey, he dead. And then I just walked off like it was nothing. Cause you know, Poison Ivy doesn't care. And we won. We actually won that one. We best group. I was so excited. I was like, my first one, and I win. And you know, it was the prize was just a T-shirt. I don't care. I won.
Yeah, it's a T-shirt.
Exactly.
I remember my first instance when I won something, and it was just like gift vouchers for local stores. But I was doing this Halloween event in Glasgow, which is like the nearest city to me. Mm-hmm. I remember sitting like a few days before going to this event, and I'm thinking, right, I don't really have an awful lot of time because I was invited very shorthanded kind of thing. And I was like, oh, well, what can I do to the costume to make it different? Because I was looking at my Harley costume and I couldn't fathom what to do with it. I was just like, oh, I'm probably just going to have to go in the same costume yet again, and that's boring. Mm-hmm. So I sat that night and I was watching TV, and The Nightmare Before Christmas came on, which is one of my favorite movies for like Halloween or Christmas. Mm-hmm. And Sally came on screen for the first time in the movie, and I was like, that's it. So I contacted a friend of mine and said, right, I'm going to send you my red and black T-shirt, which I asked you to stitch very lazily together, and I want you to put bigger stitches in it and cut it so that you can put white diamonds in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I did a gender bender / Harley Quinn and Sally from Nightmare on Elm.
That's awesome.
Christmas. And oddly enough, when I went, it was sort of Nightmare Before Christmas themed.
Yeah.
And a lot of people were dressed as Jack Skellington and Harley, and There was one person dressed as Oogie Boogie there,
Mm-hmm.
and his costume was amazing. Like, I remember talking to him, and I said to him, "Can I just like pop your head off so that I can see you?" And he's like, "Yeah, like if you just pull the mouth open, you'll eventually be able to see my face." And the sweat that was dripping off this poor guy, I was like, "Oh my God, you must be like roasting in there." But getting back to the kind of story, so I was the only like Harley slash whatever there, and my friend was doing a zombie Joker, and he had this liquid latex kind of gash coming from his mouth, and people kept asking us, you know, "Oh, what's wrong with Joker?" And I turned around at one point and said, "Well, he got to the point last night where he pissed me off, so I hit him with my hammer. That's why
That's
he has
awesome.
a big gash." And he was telling people, you know, well, when they asked him what's wrong with Harley, he kept saying, "Oh, well, I just had to stitch him back together after killing him." And I was like, it works.
That's
So,
cool.
one of my friends actually, this is a really funny instance. So I'm walking around this particular area, right? And I'm looking at all the different stalls and what's on offer. And one of my friends who's dressed up as Classic Sally runs up to me and hugs me from behind. And the only thing I could think was, "Oh my God, I'm being attacked." And then I realized it's her, and it's like, oh. And then when I turned around, she's like, "Oh my God, you're like Sally and Harley mixing together. It's so awesome." I actually went on to win third place in that contest. And when they called me up, the funny thing was, I was actually filming this whole instance for the wonderful people over here at igameonline.net, where you might be watching this interview. I don't know. So I'm filming this, and they said, "We want to do," like, they did the special thanks to all the kids entered, and a special mention to the two nurses there from Silent Hill, whose costumes were amazing, guys. There are pictures up on my YouTube, on my Facebook. Go have a look at them because you will love them. So yeah, they gave them special mentions, and they said, "Okay, in first place, we want to welcome to the stage Milan slash Ping." And the girl that did that outfit, amazing, like so amazing, and she was in character the whole time. So like, if you go up and speak to her, she'd introduce herself as she'd say, "Oh, I'm Milan, Ping. My name's Ping," which I thought was so great. I love it when people do that. They had a girl from Kill la Kill there who got second place, and they said, "And we'd like to welcome back to the stage Patchwork Harley." And I'm just kind of like standing there with my phone filming, and I'm looking around to like see, okay, where's this Patchwork Harley? There's another Patchwork Harley here. Cool.
That's awesome.
And my friend turns to me and says, "That's you. Go.
Hey.
Go." And I'm like, "Holy crap, that is me." And the entire time, because we have to get, like, all winners need to get their pictures taken with the judges, and I'm assuming it's the same for you guys as well. The entire time that we're on the stage getting our pictures taken, I'm literally shaking with fear. And I had to come off stage, and since that happened, I just ran over to my friend and like hugged him so tightly because I wanted to cry so much.
Yeah,
I'm like, ah. But yeah, that's pretty cool. You mentioned that you have judged the masquerades before. I've had the pleasure of interviewing some people who have also judged masquerades and such likes before. I just want to ask you, just how difficult is that?
there are so many things that go into how difficult it is. First of all, when there are such amazing acts, I mean, there were at least eight acts that blew me away. And it was really hard to figure out what one was technically better than the other. I think the one that we ended up going with, and it's hilarious because there was a wardrobe malfunction during it, but it totally worked because they were two warrior Disney princesses battling each other. And it was, I mean, I believe it was Rapunzel and Tiana, and it was like freaking amazing. Arms like went flying off of their costume. Nope, they're battling. It's totally cool. It works. Well, I got a judge's award. We each got one where we got to award anyone the award for any reason we wanted to. And there was like this, oh my God, she was so adorkable. She was this just totally awkward, totally sweet girl, and she had moves, but you could tell it was her first time ever competing in a masquerade, and she was not comfortable, but the fact that she had the audacity to get up and perform and do like put her heart into it, I was like, her, she gets my award. I have so much respect for that. She gets my award. And I mean, like, this is totally not okay to say, and I don't care because, I mean, sometimes there's the skits where you're like, what were you thinking? Like, no, don't do this. Don't. And again, I'm not gonna say what or, but there were a couple that were not well-conceived ideas, and they were painful to watch. Because I was just like, oh, you need a hug. You need a hug so bad.
Has there ever been a costume that, when you've been judging, you've seen it and just went, wow, but it didn't win? Because obviously, when judging, you're comparing with X number of other people, which is something that one of the girls that I interviewed recently, she mentioned, I've seen costumes and I've looked at them and thought, I love your costume, but it didn't win due to somebody else's other costume that was more fantastic, but she felt that one should have won. Have you ever been in the same position?
Definitely. I've definitely been in a position where it's like, that something is worthy of winning, but be it because of the performances, like be it because there were and I mean, sometimes it's also because of personal preference. I mean, someone was in an Ursula costume. Oh, and I love Ursula. I love Ursula. And she looked fantastic. Every time she opened her arms, the tentacles would go up with them, and it was fantastic. But there were other things that were also really epic. There was armor that was so intricate. There were performances that were just much tighter and more engaging. So, yeah, you're like, I really wanted you to win. And it was also kind of awkward because an acquaintance of mine was in one of the performances, and his group didn't end up winning anything that year, and I felt the need to be like, look, I'm really sorry, like I was in your corner, but like I had to be professional and theirs was a better performance, I'm really sorry. And he was fine with it, like he agreed, but that was awkward.
Funny you should mention Ursula, because one of the girls that I interviewed very, I'd say roughly early on, Lulu Cosplay, and hi Lulu, I know you're probably watching this. She spoke about how she built her Ursula costume. And there's actually a funny story that she mentions, I think, in her interview about how a little baby caught a hold of one of her tentacles when she was cosplaying it. And it just ended up kind of like the baby must have been teething because she noticed one of her tentacles was wet at the end of the day, and she's like, how the hell did that happen? And I'm like, oh, hello, baby. So, and I've seen a girl who's cosplayed as Ursula who had a really amazing professional photograph done for a calendar. This year's calendar for NEUK, actually, which is a lovely little cosplay group that you can find on iGameOnLive, oh, sorry, iGameOnline.net. So go have a look at those stuff, their stuff, guys. You'll love it. But yeah, whenever I see an Ursula cosplayer, I want them to break into that song. Poor, unfortunate soul. I want it to happen.
Well, I mean, it's
Whenever.
one of Disney's like most epic songs. I mean, how could you not?
I
Like,
know.
I will admit it's only my third favorite of the Disney songs though. I mean, my favorite is always gonna be Best of Friends from Fox and the Hound. And you know what? If any of you out there are referring to the Fox and the Hound as the Dark Age of Disney, then
Do you know what I say to people like that? I say, guess what, guys? Snow White, The Little Mermaid, The Lion King, all of those ones that you prefer being in the late age of Disney, really not when you read the original Hans Christensen
Christian
novel.
Anderson.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you read those novels, they're really not like. I hate saying this on like a recording, but Rapunzel was, no, sorry, Sleeping Beauty was a mother long before she woke up.
It was the baby suckling the needle out of her breast that woke her up.
Exactly.
Very dark tale. That's actually The Snow Queen is one of my favorite books. Again, third favorite book. But Frozen made me so angry. I hate that movie so much. And it's so funny because the first defense anyone has for it is, but it's so great that they didn't need a man to save them. You know what? Neither did Alice, and she was younger. So take that argument and stuff it. Merida also didn't need a man to save her. Like, it's been done before, and it's been done better. It's not a defense of Frozen.
The
I'm
only thing
sorry. I hate that movie so much.
Do you know what I feel so sorry for? Because I remember watching an interview with the woman who sung the Let It Go song.
Idina Menzel.
Yes, and I love Idina Menzel. Like, I think she is a fantastic singer. I could listen to her sing forever. She mentions her like run on Glee and how she is supposed to be the mother of the girl that plays Rachel. And she actually mentions she'd not, before she just did that role, she'd just had her son. And she was then being asked to play the mother of this 19 whatever year old girl. And at the time, the girl who was playing Rachel was somewhere in her 20s. So she was like, do I really look that old? And then they go on to talking about Frozen's Let It Go song, and her son's got to the point now where he just can't be bothered listening to that song because he associates that song with mum being taken away from him because mum has to work when it comes to that song. And I just think that is so sad, but the song is so bloody good, you know.
Yeah, and I'll give it that, like, as I'm averse to the song only because of associating it with the movie, but when I'm able to divorce it, like, it's a good song. But You Want to Build a Snowman is a better song. I like that better. Like,
I've heard so many parodies about that song that it's literally lost all feeling and meaning to me.
see, again, now that since I disliked the movie so much, I avoid it at all costs. So I don't run into that happening to me.
Credits.
Although, of course, it does lead to when I'm out with friends, the ones who are more acquaintance than friends will be like, "Oh, look, it's Frozen, Jason! Look, look, look!" And I'm like, "Yeah, okay. Like, You're showing me something I don't like. I mean, look, it's a lemon.
So my next question for you is, we spoke a bit there. In your opinion, what is the best and the worst things that new cosplayers can do when they're getting ready to do a cosplay?
I think one of the best things that people can do is do research on your character. There's a lot of people who I want to run and help them because, their costume's amazing, and then they do these poses that are like, oh, sweetie, no, when you're doing Jean Grey, for instance, this is not like a good pose. All you have to do is change it a little bit, and I'm like, no, honey, let's get some power into it. Let's get some, or when you see someone like in a Spider-Man costume and they're posing, but they're like, hey, what's up? I'm kind of like, are you like hanging 10? I don't know. What's up? Let's get you dynamic. Let's do something. So I think the best thing you can do is to learn about your character, learn what their poses are, learn, when I did Kai Kisuke, I played the video game for about 3 hours just to look at different ways that he held his sword, the defensive posturing, the offensive posturing, all that stuff, because I wanted all of my poses to really pop and be epic. And I think that it's most disappointing when it's a fantastic costume and then someone just doesn't know what to do. But I'm also the annoying one who will run up and help them and be like, okay, look, 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 we could do this, 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 and this, and your pictures are going to be amazing. So yeah, I think the best thing they can do is research the character, and the worst thing they could do is just not, and to sit there with, like, when you don't know what to do with your hands in pictures, I think that's the worst.
I think one of the other things as well is don't be afraid if you're having pictures professionally done, don't be afraid to ask the photographer how they want you to pose.
Don't be afraid to demand to be told how to pose. If you're taking professional pictures, you need direction.
I remember getting one done as Poison Ivy this year, and I've actually had quite a few done professionally this year. But the photographer that I was working with for one or two shots this year wasn't my normal photographer. And I did say to him, I said, okay, how do you want me to pose? And he's like, well, he looked at me and he said, who are you first? Because he was a little unsure. And I was kind of like, really?
Oh no.
Really? And I was like, well, I'm supposed to be Poison Ivy. And he said, okay, well, and I said, do you want me to, when I said Poison Ivy, he knew then, and I was like, okay, that's good then. I was like, do you want me to pose sexy, or do you just want me to pose with, like, I had this tiny little flower prop with me, with it. And he's like, well, you can pose with it then, or whatever way you want. And when he said whatever way you want, it just kind of like sent a shockwave back to me, and I'm like, how do I pose then? Likewise, I did actually get to work with my photographer that I'm used to working with, Anthony. And hi, Anthony. He is fantastic. Anthony took me aside at one point, and there was various different poses which I haven't posted yet, guys, and I'm very sorry about that. That he got me to do next to a window, and then next to a blue wall. The one with the blue wall, we're working and getting some graphics into the background so that it looks like I'm in a forest or something. Because going outside that day, as much as I would have loved to, it was so freaking cold. Like, people, when we were in the queue to get professional photos done, somebody, like a staff member to the venue, opened a door, this blast of cold air come in, hit every other cosplayer, and they went. I was like, shut the door, just close the door, please. I am frozen. and I am not turning into Elsa and singing Let It Go. Just shut the goddamn door. So yeah, it would have been nice to go outside, but it looked, it actually, if you look at the ones of me at the window, they look really, it looks like a really nice day, but it's really not.
Right.
But yeah, like I say, guys, or like both said, research a character, look at how they pose, try and imitate that, but also don't be afraid to ask the photographer either A, to pose you, or how you want to be posed, or how
well,
you want to be posed.
One of the best photographers I worked with, Eric Hahn in Waterbury. Hey, Eric! He kept apologizing. He would like take his hand and he would like move it just a little bit. And I'm like, stop apologizing. That's what I want. You're doing a great job. Because if you look at the pictures, that was me and my best friend doing Arrow and Arsenal, and we were just running around all over downtown Waterbury, and for some parts of it, we were in some pretty not nice areas, full costume, bow and arrow out. And, you know, he's taking all these amazing pictures, and he was micromanaging us in such a perfect way. The pictures came out so good. I mean, I could not be happier with those pictures. And I'm so thankful that he kept micromanaging every single picture.
And that's a good thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing. If you're a photographer and you're watching these interviews, it's not a bad thing to micromanage a cosplayer.
Exactly.
Do ask them, because they might have a specific idea in their head that's similar to your own.
Right.
So my next question is about age differences at Comic-Cons. When I first got the notion to cosplay inside my head, I had this idea after, like, I'd seen pictures of people cosplaying over in the States, and I was like, oh right, so you do get families that will go along and cosplay, and you'll get grannies and granddads and all the rest, and that's cool. But I thought, there's no way that that's ever going to happen over here. It's going to be people in like their mid-teens to maybe mid-30s.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Right.
That will be the demographic of the age group. And then when I went, I seen so many different people cosplaying. I seen families, I seen grannies, granddads, aunts, uncles, kids, you know, babies even, all in cosplay. And I was like, whoa. You know, when you first started your journey in cosplay, did you have a similar notion of like, there's this age group and that's the age group that cosplays?
Not in general. I've had events that I've looked at the list of people, and honestly I've been like, okay, it's gonna be really creepy if I go to this event, because this is all teenagers and I'm old AF, you know. I just turned 40 2 days ago, so it's like I don't want to go to events and be like the, hey, where's the party, kids? Because, you know, that's kind of creepy. So, you know, like, I try to look at who's going to be where. But I find that in most of the events, I mean, I'm friends with a family who, you know, the husband and wife, husband and wife-to-be, they're getting married in a month. They both, yeah, they're awesome. Rhonda and Jimmy, hey, guys. They're doing these big epic costumes, and then their daughter Alyssa, who is, you know, I think she's 18, does a really cute Harley, and it's fun watching this whole family. And then, you know, actually it's really funny actually, because I met this girl Shannon, Shantastic Cosplay Shannon, through another friend of mine, but it turns out that her whole family gets together and cosplays. And when I finally met her mother, who happens to be a coworker of mine in one of the other locations, her mother was dressed as Voldemort, and it was fantastic. I mean, I think you come across such a vast array of people. And I mean, when I'm seeing even babies in cosplay, I'm like, yes, this is parenting done right. Like, it makes me very happy.
On the subject of babies, the Comic Con that I went to recently had Sean Astin at it. And with Sean Astin being there, obviously there's going to be a lot of people dressing up in Lord of the Rings outfits. I got a really awesome picture, and this is actually on my Facebook, of a girl dressed as Arwen, and her friend was dressed, or I don't know, might be her boyfriend, I don't know, as Aragorn. And I got a picture of them both in the same position twice, like a full body one to show off the entire outfit because the outfits were amazing. Like, oh my god, amazing. And then a closer one of the two of them just so that it looked as if they were about to suck face, whatever. I don't know. And later on in the day, I noticed there was this little baby around. And I, you know, it's like, oh, baby. But this baby was actually dressed up to look like a hobbit. And
That's
I was
awesome.
like, that is so cute. And I think he's like a few spaces away from where I was on the masquerade. But I don't know whether he'll have been picked up on my camera because my camera was very far away from the stage
Right.
during the recording, which is also on YouTube, guys, so go watch that after you're finished here. But I was so happy to see that little baby there. I was just like, oh my god, that's so great, and it's so cute. And it's something that Sean Astin, if that baby was kind of like taken to see him, would appreciate. You know, because Sean Astin loves stuff like that. He loves like the pure geekiness side of life. So I was so happy to see that. Another thing I want to ask in terms of the age difference, a lot of groups in society kind of say, oh, it's wrong to dress up your child and have them march around things like Comic Con. You shouldn't do that. That's parenting that's bad. Bad parenting. Are you one of those kind of people who agree with a lot of other cosplayers when I ask them this question and say, the child would let you know if they did not want to be there or would not want to be in costume?
Yeah, I'm totally with that. I think that people spend too much time worried about what parents do with their children. You know, like a lot of people need to butt the hell out of other people's business. And I think that's one of those cases.
I just want to add to that, guys, that children love dressing up. Like, I've been very fortunate enough to work with children in the past, and any time I brought out the dress-up box, it was literally empty within 2 minutes of me putting it out. You know,
2 minutes? That took a long time for them
well,
then.
2 minutes, 2 seconds, you know, like you'd put it out,
Yeah.
you'd go away somewhere and come back and it was empty basically.
Yeah.
But kids love dressing up, and it's like at the end of the night, it was such a nightmare trying to get them to put the stuff back into the box
Oh,
because
yeah.
they just didn't want to do it. And you're like, I kind of want to go. Equally, when we were talking about children there, have you ever seen the like the grannies and the granddads at the cons and they're in cosplay? Have you ever experienced that?
Do you know who Cosplay Dad is?
No,
Okay,
unfortunately.
dude, look him up. I've met him a few times. He's not a close friend of mine, but I run into him at a lot of cons. He does, oh geez, what's the old man's from Up, the old man? He does him, and he does him perfectly. But then he also does Grunkle Stan from Gravity Falls, and when I saw him in that recently, I'm just like, ah, because I mean he's perfect. He is perfect as these characters. And I mean when people do that stuff, I also saw a woman. I mean she had to be an octogenarian, and she was dressed up as Wonder Woman, and I nearly died.
I've seen that Facebook meme. Seen that. She's got a stroke, well, a walker. I referenced this to a lot of the people from the United Kingdom about this woman. Wasn't she like, she was celebrating her birthday, And when they asked her, what do you want to do for your birthday? She said, I want to go to Comic Con. I can't remember how old she was for her birthday. It was like, I don't know, like 90 or something like that. I don't want to pry. 90, 70, maybe 80, I don't know. But she said, I want to go to Comic Con. And she, you don't deny somebody of said age what they want to do on their birthday. It's just not cool. But the thing, when they asked her, they said, okay, so we'll go to Comic Con. She then says, I want to go as Wonder Woman. I mean, how, if you're working at DC, and specifically if you're related to the guy who created Wonder Woman, how awesome is that to have this so many years old woman say, well, I've been around for the entire time Wonder Woman has been about. I want to cosplay as her. I mean, just how, I can't even fathom how the people at DC would feel, or the relations to the Wonder Woman guy. It's just like, that is such a great thing, you know. Equally over here, we have a lot of people of a certain age group that cosplay as Doctor Who. And Doctor Who's, well, I live in the country of its origins, so I think it's so great for us because whenever we reach a certain age, we can always say, oh, well, I can cosplay as this doctor or this character from Doctor Who. And I think it's a really cheap and cheesy way to get a good notice.
I am currently mad at Doctor Who right now.
Oh.
I will share with you that I cried for about 3 hours after Clara died. Because for them to take a character that I absolutely hated, I hated Clara, okay? The first season that she was in it, I was like, oh my God, Jenna Elfman, stop. Elfman, oh my God, I called her Jenna Elfman. You know who I mean. I'm just like, no, you need to stop. This isn't cute. I don't like it. And they turned her so complex and so likable, and I fell in love with her. Only my second favorite companion, though, because Catherine Tate will always have my heart.
Have you watched her comedy sketch show before?
Face, look at my face. I'm above a die. I do an absolutely shite accent, but I love Lauren Cooper.
I think my favorite character has to be Nan, because
I
I
was gonna say, if
love.
not Nan, I'll be very sad because you seem very, you know. Can you do her laugh?
No, I
Aww.
can't. For me, it's the scenarios because she's always opposite. Crap, I'm forgotten his name.
Ryan, like,
No.
no, his character's name in
Yeah,
the
the show. She's always opposite him, and it's always the expressions that he's left with. Like, you know.
Yeah, I actually it's sometimes when my when Glimmer, my dog, comes up to me, I'll admit, I'm like, come up to see me. Come up to see me there. Come up to see me. Oh, you're a good girl. And of course, she's my dog, so she just goes,
Okay.
yeah.
But yeah, if you hadn't seen that show, I would have recommended go watch it. It is hilarious.
The first time I was watching that, I was actually flying to England from Los Angeles.
Oh.
I was working, yeah, I spent a week, well, 11 days. I spent 11 days in Hampshire, and that was on the little TVs in the because I was in business class. I was a sober companion, and I was laughing so hard. I was disrupting the entire plane, but I couldn't stop because it was so amazing. It was so funny. And I mean, I think my favorite of all her skits is the chemistry exam for Lauren Cooper, especially when she takes her binder and smacks the skeleton. I'm just like, ah!
Do you know the best one that I've seen with Lauren Cooper? And I think it was like a one-off special. She gets married to I think it's Ryan.
Well, she's about to marry him.
Yeah. And she comes up against the vicar, and she keeps asking her, "Are you the vicar of Dibley?
Yes.
Are you the vicar of Dibley, though?" And then the vicar gets really frustrated throughout the sketch about how Lauren is being. And she just kind of, like, loses it with her when, after the guy, like, runs off and leaves her at the altar. She kind of is like, "Are you all right? Are you sure you're okay?" And she's like, "I'm not bothered." And then she said, "May God forgive you, because I certainly can't, you stupid little blah, 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 blah." And then you hear this crack of thunder, which is obviously supposed to be the big Geordie. And she just turns and says, "Still ain't bothered."
but come on, also the one with David Tennant for Red Nose Day was fantastic.
"I still ain't bothered."
Have you seen the one with Tony Blair for Red Nose Day?
Oh my God, that man has a sense of humor. It was fantastic. It was fantastic. Yeah, I'm a huge fan. I also do love Little Britain, but Little Britain USA is a flaming piece of shit. Because it's like they took all the smart stuff and said, "Oh, we don't need that because we're for Americans. We're going to add a bunch of dick humor." And I wasn't
one thing that I liked about the USA one was the Fat Fighter sketch. Because I loved the Fat Fighter sketch from Little Britain in general.
Right.
Whenever I picture, like, these meetups, that's what I picture.
Okay. You know? Okay.
I picture this not overweight individual that runs it, but semi-overweight. Mm-hmm. And they're telling everybody else, "Right, you need to diet because you're fat."
Right.
You know? And I'm like, that is such a hypocritical thing to say.
So here's actually a funny one for you. I met Matt at a, when I was in Los Angeles, I was there when Prop 8 was initially voted in. So I was going to a lot of the protests, and Matt actually flew over to be a part of one. And I mean, I met him for like 2 seconds. It's not like, I mean, I was like, "Hey, how's it going?" And he's like, "Oh, hi." And you know, that was like it. But like, I saw him talking to everyone. He seems like a really nice guy, kind of awkward, but I like awkward people because, you know, cosplay.
Mm-hmm. He is quite awkward. And David Walliams, who he plays opposite on the show, is such an interesting guy as well, because my mother has actually met him. She met him once at something that she went to, and she spoke to him for all of like a few seconds or something. And she said he's such a reserved individual, but at the same time, you know that any moment he could just go.
Right.
There's so many different sketches on the British version of that I love as well.
I like it.
Yeah.
Like, the wheelchair guy is hilarious. Like, that... I can't choose a favorite, though. There's so many good ones.
I've yet to see that cosplayed as over here in the United Kingdom. I'd love to see that cosplayed as.
No one would understand what you were doing here.
No. I think it's more likely to happen here because the Comic-Con that I just did... last month, there was a guy who did, and I don't know whether you'll know this character, Rab C. Nesbitt, which...
Yes, the little guy, right?
He did Rab C. Nesbitt, and I knew who that was, because obviously I grew up over here.
Right.
But I never liked that show because of the humor in it.
Mm-hmm.
I just didn't get it. I thought Rab C. Nesbitt was this, like, drunken loudmouth, which he kind of was, you know. But seeing that made me very, very hopeful to see the Little Britain Andy and his long-suffering cure.
Right.
But I think that would need to be a dual cosplay between two people in it, and I'd need to suggest it to a couple of my friends and say, "Hey, you know, Would you maybe do that cosplay so I can get a few photos?
You know, I should really tell my best friend Hit Cosplay, hey Matt, that he should do the David Walliams character, and I'll do the because
Andy.
I already do Professor X, so why not do Andy too, you know?
Exactly.
Again, no one would understand it, but it could still be hilarious.
It definitely would be. So going back to the age difference thing in Doctor Who, because we kind of veered off there, which is
Way
cool.
off.
Which is cool, because, we get to know the person behind the cosplay. I feel that it's really cool over here because obviously we have all the Doctor Who stars live in our country kind of thing, so there's always one of them at a Comic Con. Is it something that you've noticed by chance starting to be more popular over in the States? Because, like,
Starting, dude. Like, I don't think you know, like, how crazy, like, rabid
in terms
the
of like people cosplaying as the Doctor from
Oh,
that show,
all over. I mean, there's actually I'm friends with someone. If you look on my cosplay page, there's pictures from the Finish at the 50 event. The guy who is dressed as Flash in those pictures is part of the Boston Whovians, and he dresses as, oh, I'm gonna lose some Doctor Who cred right now because I can't remember what number he is. The one with the crazy patchwork jacket.
The fourth, I think.
No, that isn't the fourth. Isn't the fourth Tom Baker?
This shows how much I don't watch it, and I live in the freaking country that it's made in and
Right.
publicized most in.
It makes me feel a little better, but it's the yeah, he dresses as the one with the crazy jacket. And he talks about how much he loves that particular doctor. It's interesting, you run into a lot of women who are dressed in different versions of the TARDIS dress. I have never been to a con and not seen a Dalek, which honestly makes me very happy. What else do people like? I mean, people do the doctor all the time now. If I do the doctor, I am going to do the current doctor, which unfortunately will require quite a wig because no hair at all. I mean, I guess I could do number nine, but I would have to draw hair on because you can never get a wig that's that short. I don't find the there's any con where people aren't dressed up. Although there was a doctor at I went to Vermont Comic Con and there was a doctor that was kind of freaking me out because he was a little bit too much into whatever he was listening to on his headphones, and he was like getting into it in the mirror, and I'm like angry face, and I'm just like, I'm gonna get between you and him, girls, because I just don't like what's happening here. Like, it was a bizarre situation, but yeah, I mean, there's doctors
It's like when we sometimes the Comic Con events like San Diego tend to live stream their events, which they didn't do this year in naughty San Diego. How dare you? Because I was looking forward to watching 3 days of Comic Con goodness, which didn't happen. But whenever we see like the live streams or photographs, there's not always an awful lot of Doctor Who characters that have been put on camera, or there's been a photograph snapped of them. So that's the reason I ask. It's more so I think common over here, because like I say, we get the stars coming to every single con under the calendar kind of thing,
Right.
and a lot more people are gonna cosplay the whatever doctor because said celebrity is gonna be there and they want to impress them. What we do see a lot of from you guys as like the likes of the superheroes and the occasional what's in on TV at the moment, like people from Game of Thrones and such likes. But yeah, it's good to know that we have got Doctor Who followers over in the States that are cosplaying as various doctors or various characters from the show.
Oh, wait a minute. If you want to give me a second, I can pull something out from under my bed that sure. you might be... It'll just take a sec. So, one of my close friends knows what a big Doctor Who fan I am. Mm-hmm. And I got...
Oh, wow!
K9 slippers.
You're going to hate me so much from what I'm about to tell you. I actually got the chance to get my picture taken with K9.
That's awesome. Being,
like, Ivy. But I didn't take it. Because, to me, I didn't know fully what K9 was at the time.
Right.
So I was like, to me, there's no point getting my picture taken with something I don't really know an awful lot about.
Yeah.
But I very politely said to the guy, no. But he did ask me, do you want to play with the controls a little bit and, like, scoot them around? And I did do that, and that was so much fun.
So much fun. That's really cool.
I say to anybody who ever gets the opportunity to do something like that, take it. Because it is so fun.
When I went to Vermont Comic Con, I had the chance to... It was $5 to get your picture in the mouth of Audrey 2. But I was dressed as Dark Phoenix, and I was kind of mad that I was dressed as Dark Phoenix, not Ivy. Because if I was Ivy, like...
Perfect.
I would have gotten at least 3 pictures. Like, no problem. That would have been amazing. But as Dark Phoenix, I'm like, it doesn't really make sense.
One thing that I did do this year was I got my picture taken next to Groot.
That's awesome.
And one of the funniest things, as soon as I had that picture taken, I came to get the print out, and the woman who printed it out just looked at it and went, "Oh, you make such a lovely couple." And I just kind of walked away from that thinking, yeah, you're not wrong.
There were a lot of Poison Ivy, Swamp Thing, and Groot family photos at the last con I was at.
I think I actually have it here, the original picture.
That's awesome. That came out really cool.
It did.
You guys are a lovely couple.
I know. Big tree type thing, and I don't know what Poison Ivy really can be classed as.
Eco-terrorist.
Meta-human, maybe. But yeah, so there was that. My next question for you, now this is a big question, so I hope you're ready for this, or it's at least a 3-parter.
Okay.
Props. Now, props for me fall into 3 categories. You have your big props that are back-breaking. You have your medium-sized props, which are not back-breaking and can maybe go into a bag. And then you have your small handheld props that can easily go into a pocket, a bag, or whatever. Which of the 3 props do you mostly work with, and which out of the 3 props are you more inclined to take to a big Comic-Con event? Or a Comic-Con event in general?
Yes. I would say I like working with all of them. I guess I don't work with a lot of the really big ones. I do have some weapons that are fairly large. I mean, my Kai Kisuke sword is over 5 feet long. Mm-hmm. Because it's thin, I don't really consider it to be one of the big back-breaking ones. But one of the problems with a lot of weapons now, because of the recent, rash of violence we're getting across the entire country, a lot of weapons are being banned from cons. So it's hard to bring those. My Poison Ivy plant was fairly big, but, I had arranged it so it could, it's a hands-free prop, and I can touch it where I want to, stroke my babies. But I guess I would say my medium are my favorite to work with because they give me the most to do with and they show up better in pictures. Small props can be really good for close-ups, but if you're walking around a con with a small prop, people don't usually notice. And I get so excited when I see some people's small props. Someone did Toph from The Last Airbender, and she did her with a rock that she connected with a fishing line, so she could look like she was rock bending. But most people couldn't see it until they were really up close. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't help but think, you know, well, that's awesome, but you should have done it, you know, bigger so that people could see it from a distance and people would come running to take pictures with you. Because she had the contacts, the costume was amazing. And it's hard because, again, she was small, so people weren't noticing her. And I mean, come on. What cosplayer doesn't want to be noticed, right? Like, it's part of the fun. So, I mean, I guess medium would be my favorite, but having some small ones, you know, like I made some Robin birdarangs, which, you know, I don't think I've ever taken a picture with the birdarangs. I've taken pictures with the staff and with the Escrima sticks that I made, but not with the birdarangs yet. I'm going to have to fix that. Yeah, medium would be my favorite. One of these days, actually, if I redo Alan Walker, like I'm planning to do for Anime Boston, I'm planning on doing him with the ginormous sword and then the cape that covers the arm that the sword is supposed to actually be. Mm-hmm. So there will be a big back-breaking sword at a con, and I'll probably want to shoot myself in the face. Because it's Anime Boston, and that's a huge, busy one.
In terms of props that you use for a photo shoot, are you more inclined to use the bigger props then?
Again, I think it's going to depend. Oh, I actually have a doorbell ringing. Give me a second.
No problem. And we're back. So in terms of big props, a photo shoot, are you more inclined to bring in a big prop then, or do you still prefer working with the smaller or
I would say for tight shots I would rather have a smaller thing, because, you know, if you're getting my torso up or something, like even if I'm like just holding my sword behind me, it's like you don't really see it, so what's the point? Mm-hmm. Having a smaller prop to play with for tight shots is great, but for the more distant stuff, I would much rather have a medium to large prop. And I mean, I think that's the perfect place for those back-breaking, like, huge, huge things that, because not having to carry it around a con all day is perfect.
Yeah.
You know.
Last question about props. Do you buy them in, make your own, or do you buy them in and then customize them?
Again, I'd go with yes, because it's going to depend on what I do. And I've gotten more into making my props in the last year. Before, I was buying them and I was having them custom made by other people, but I would make customizations to what they made for me, or I would buy something that was close to what I wanted and customize it. But nowadays, I mean, that entire poison ivy plant, that was all me. That was all me. And I'm not someone who gets, I'm pretty humble in general, but that prop came out awesome. Like, I can't be humble about it because it came out awesome.
How long did it take you to make that one?
I would say it was 2 days. And I mean, it's only a wireframe that was... I have a female mannequin, so I bent the wire around her. That was the part that had me swearing, because that was frustrating. But then I coated the wire itself in insulation foam, and then the heads are made out of Ava foam with craft foam accents for, you know, other petals and leaves and stuff. And painting it was so much fun. It was so much fun playing with spray paint.
Awesome. My next question for you is a very generalized one. What opportunities or things has cosplay opened up for you?
I would say the charity work again. I mean, the charity work is so meaningful to me. Being able to go to events and make little kids that happy is one of the best things that I've been able to do. I mean, I already feel like I make quite a difference in my day-to-day life as a therapist in my day job, but this is very different. This is making a little kid or even like adolescents absolutely thrilled and, you know, really give them an experience. And it's really empowering. And I love that. I absolutely love that. And I wouldn't have it without cosplay.
Awesome. So my next question for you, now this is hopefully going to be a little bit of a tidbit for everybody watching. Can you tell us three costumes, one that you're going to be doing at your next event, one that you're planning to do before the end of the year, and one that you're thinking about doing for next year?
So for New York Comic Con, I'm working on Captain America. Mm-hmm. The costume is done. I'm waiting on the boots, and I need to make the cowl all by myself because, again, being little, I have a little head. And most of people that make it do a 1-to-1 scale with Chris Evans' head, mm-hmm. which is sizably larger than my own because he's sizably larger than I am. I am hoping that I can get a Null from the X-Men done in the next year. I would really like to do a Null for Kineticon this upcoming year. I'm not sure if that'll happen, but I have a plan on how to make everything that I'm going to make. Here's one that I really want to do, and I don't know if it's going to happen. I want to do the red guy from Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared. It's absolutely ridiculous that I want to do him because it's such a, like, everything's covered, and I just kind of have to walk around looking, like, with my body kind of depressed all day. That sounds really boring. Again, I can't do the accent to save my life, but I don't care because I love Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared because I'm dark.
So lastly, before we do the Passover and you can tell us where we can catch up with you on social media, I want to ask the difficult question, or maybe not so difficult question. What advice would you give to any of you or somebody who would like to start cosplaying but really just doesn't know where to start?
Message someone you like. If you see someone on Facebook, I tell everyone that I'm a jerk, but I'm only a jerk to mean people. Like, if someone sends me a message and they're like, hey, you really inspire me and, you know, I really want to cosplay, I'll be like, okay, let's look at it. Let's look at it. You're not ready to make a costume? I will help you find a costume. What do you want to do? How do you want to do it? Let's do it. Because most cosplayers are really friendly. I have come across very few who are legit snotty, and most of them are happy to start a conversation with you and would love to be able to inspire and mentor you. So reach out to other people and don't be shy. What's the worst they're going to do? Not respond?
Exactly. And what I'll add to that is, the cosplay, like any cosplay community, doesn't matter where it is in the world, is so friendly, guys. I have been very, very fortunate to speak to people across the world. I've spoken to people in Japan, I've spoken to people in the States, I've spoken to people in the UK, and each and every one of them is so helpful, so friendly, and they make you feel at ease, you know. When I've messaged Jason after doing my Ivy, I was like, okay, here's my Ivy. I loved your Ivy. How did you achieve that? And he told me very simply, like, this is how I did it. I stitched it in, and I was like, maybe I should have done that. You know, just maybe. But I obviously sent him through the pictures and said, here is what I did. So I have
and
an
it was
idea
really
in my
cool.
head.
It was really cool to see it because it was like, oh, hey, this is a guy who did a very different take on the same character, and it's inspiring to see everyone else's creativity in action.
Definitely. So I want to take this time before we completely finish up to pass over to your good self and say to you, where can we follow you on social media if we have any further questions? Also, don't forget, guys, we do have a comment section down there, so do put in a comment and maybe we'll reply to it. Also, don't forget to go have a look at iGame Online. There will be a link in the description, or there'll be a tag for it in the video, or a card, which should be up in the corner up there. So yes, also don't forget to give us a big thumbs up and subscribe to my channel for more videos on Inside Cosplay. So where can we follow you if we have any further questions?
I think the best way to get in touch with me is either through Facebook. It's just facebook.com ShiroiOji, which is ShiroiOji. Again, that's facebook.com/ShiroiOji. You can find me on Instagram and Twitter as the Snarky Gay Guy. I post the most there, but I'm really trying to focus on pumping up my Facebook page. So I'm up to 700 likes. Help me out.
Awesome. So don't forget, guys, there will be links to all of the social media in the description of this video. Do go along and favorite, like, subscribe, whatever. And support the cosplay movement in general. So once again, I'd like to thank my special guest for taking the time out and spending it with us. So
thank you. Bye. That was a lot of fun.
Thank you for coming. So bye, guys.